GNAT Project Manager, Part 11, Pre-Release Details. Before discussing control of the source code format, let's return briefly to the programming activity. Code is written once, but read many times by many different people, especially during the maintenance phase where applications spend the majority of their lives. Therefore, it is very important that the format of the code be consistent throughout the lifetime of the application. Most organizations publish style guides to document the required source code format. However, such requirements are difficult to manually enforce, and style guides tend to be ignored. To guarantee compliance and make programming more efficient, everything to do with source code formatting must be automated. One way to ensure that all sources of the version control system are correctly formatted is to create a mechanism that submits each source file to a format and compile process before the actual check-in takes place. We cannot assume, however, that the correct check-in procedure is always followed. Perhaps someone bypasses the mechanism in GPS and uses a version control system directly to check in a unit. Therefore, a quality assurance process is needed to ensure that every unit conforms to the mandated format. Details of the format are specified in the pretty printer package of the release project file on drive R, which is read-only. This process verifies that all source code units conform to the official formatting standard. Step 1, make a copy of the official release and map the copy to drive R. Steps 2 and 3, submit the release project file configured as a subsystem to the GNAT Pretty Printer tool. This will cause every unit in the subsystem to be formatted according to the rules embedded in the project file. Note the use of the X switch to override the default value of the scenario variable specified in the project file. Steps 4 and 5. A utility is used to compare each newly formatted unit on the release drive against a corresponding unit on the version drive. Now, if everybody followed the rules, no differences will be reported, which is what we expect. If, however, a difference is detected, then we need to investigate how unformatted code ended up in the version control system, followed by a format of one or more units, then it's back to part 10. In step 6, the copy is deleted and the original is mapped back to drive R. In this process, we verify that the software conforms to the coding standard by checking the source code against a set of semantic rules specified in an external file. The path to this file is specified in the GNAT check in the check package of the release project, which is inherited by the workspace and therefore available to each developer. Now, we'd like to think that no developer would check in a unit without first running GNAT check and doing whatever is necessary to eliminate any reported violations. However, we cannot make this assumption, and therefore the entire subsystem must be submitted to a GNAT check process. Examples of coding violations might appear in the report are things like exit statement with no loop name, use of equality operation for float values, anonymous array type, and so on. For those rare cases where a violation of a coding standard can be justified, the rationale for the rule exemption must be provided in the source code so that reviewers and maintainers can understand the reasoning behind the decision. Except the violations, along with their justification, are documented in a special section of the generated report file. Implementing a rule exemption for a specific code section is accomplished using Pragma Annotate with four parameters, namely GNAT check, exempt on slash off, the rule name, and a string describing the justification. For details, refer to the GNAT check manual. This process represents the final code review. The primary objective is to identify possible programming errors, verify the logical correctness of algorithms, determine the suitability of data structures, and prevent anti-patterns from polluting the code base. Fortunately, a technology exists which largely automates this process to make traditional labor-intensive code reviews a thing of the past and greatly reduces the effort and costs associated with runtime testing. The technology I'm referring to is called CodePeer, a static analysis tool for Ada. Programmers interact with CodePeer from GPS during the development of components, and obviously any problems detected by CodePeer are corrected immediately. Since we don't expect an avalanche of defect reports, we submit the entire subsystem to CodePeer to run during the night. In the morning, the QA manager will examine the output. If a problem is found, a ticket is created and sent to the development team, who will investigate and correct the problem. Once the automated code review indicates a pass, an analysis summary is produced and published on the intranet to be examined by various experts who will decide if the release is ready to enter the test lab or not. CodePeer is a CPU-intensive application that requires about a minute to inspect 1,000 lines of code on a dual-core 2 GHz workstation. If the CodePeer job were sent to a high-end 64-bit build server, capable of processing 2,000 lines per minute, then after 12 hours of dedicated computing time, the code review for a subsystem consisting of around 1.4 million lines of code should be ready. This is a realistic code size for a subsystem in a very large application. Test coverage report. We need to ensure that all source code associated with a given component is completely covered by regression tests before it can be released. For that purpose, the development environment provides a tool called GNAT coverage. What we have here is a coverage report after running component AO3 in the prototype. As you can see, code coverage is not complete. In a real project, this situation would not be acceptable since uncovered code is untested code, which is assumed to be defective until proven otherwise. The runtime profile report allows us to examine the flow of control as a function of time and to observe the pattern of calls between functions. This information is used to expose bottlenecks and hotspots that affect performance and reliability. If an inordinate amount of time is being spent in a specific function or object, then additional work in the design is required. The package metrics in the release project specifies the kinds of metrics to be measured. The report appears as an XML formatted file, and the corresponding XML schema is also generated. So once the quality assurance phase is finished, we should see this report. All source code is formatted correctly. No violations of coding standard rules were reported. No potential runtime problems were detected by the automated code review process. Every line of code is covered by one or more regression tests. Profiling indicates no bottlenecks, and all program metrics are within acceptable bounds. So we're almost finished. Just a few more items to wrap up. Once the release has been signed off, AdaDoc is generated in a subdirectory called doc under build. And finally, all files in the release are set to read-only, and the corresponding state of the release in the version control system is frozen. Incidentally, the generated AdaDoc has some nice features that enable efficient browsing of the code base from any machine with access to the company intranet. Here's a status report of the wrap-up phase. AdaDoc has been generated from the source code. All files in the release on drive R are set to read-only. The release in the version control system is tagged and frozen. A new version number is assigned to the baseline release on drive R. And finally, the development and test teams are informed that the release is ready to use. With these activities completed, developers can start implementing new features, and domain experts in the test lab can do what they do best, which is making sure that the right thing is being built. Note that developers have access to both the test lab and domain experts near the end of a release cycle for the purpose of finding bugs under simulated conditions. However, after the test lab is formally handed over to the domain experts, the developers cannot use the lab until near the end of the current cycle. This is the end of part 11.